Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the museum. My name is John Holler. I'm the CEO, and on behalf of the trustees, our staff, our members, and everyone involved with the museum, it's a pleasure to welcome you here tonight to this event. It is the latest installment in our series of programs on the 40th anniversary of the events that led to today's fully wired world. I want to begin by thanking Intel for serving as the lead sponsor of our Net at 40 series. Intel is a very generous supporter and a good friend of the museum, and we very much appreciate their underwriting of these programs. Along the way, we've also had support from Symantec Corporation and, of course, our donors and members who in the last 12 months have provided more than $2 million in support for our work. Kepler's is the museum partner for books related to our programs as they are tonight. They'll be selling the Facebook effect after our program. I want to thank Clark Kepler for their ongoing partnership. Clark is here tonight. Clark, thank you. And finally, thank you to HP and its MagCloud service, which is the partner for the publication of the booklets that are on your chairs and around the museum tonight. All of our MagCloud publications are now available for purchase online. In case you didn't get one tonight, you want to order one for a friend. A member of the museum emailed me a few days ago with this note. He said, "I hope when you're introducing the Facebook event, you'll remind everyone that we're here tonight because two guys named Klein and Duval were hunched over computers late one night in 1969 trying to send the letters L-O-G-I-N from SRI to UCLA over the ARPANET. So there, I've done my duty. Alphabet soup and all." The connection between the launch of the ARPANET and relative solitude 40 years ago and the explosion of Facebook is not linear, as we have covered in previous events and in the history that's printed tonight, but without question, our global society is surely traveling at breakneck speed down a continuum that began with L-O-G-I-N and today connects billions around the world. This journey is at its core what this museum is all about. If you reduced all of recorded human history to a 24-hour day, the birth of the internet would amount to a fraction of a second. The birth of Facebook and the socially connected electronic world, far less than that. And yet, consider the immensity of the reality that we are all living. In as little as two generations, we are moving from a time of no electronic connections at all to a time when we can hardly imagine not being connected. We, therefore, confront an interesting paradox. The blockbuster innovations of the information age are coming thick and fast, and their impact is enormous, as impactful as anything may have ever been. And yet we risk losing their history as quickly as we see their history created. This is the essence of the work of the museum. We're seeking to capture the stories, the firsthand accounts, the lessons learned, and the physical and digital products of both genius and failure in our time. Or as Donna Dubinsky put it in her famous analogy from the film you saw a moment ago, to talk to Michelangelo as he paints the Sistine Chapel. One big difference, of course, is that from time to time, an historian of Michelangelo's era might have found him flat on his back atop a scaffolding. We don't find many people sitting still. So what we are attempting is contemporary history at speed. It's humbling and it's challenging. But with the help of many hundreds of people, we're determined to make it work and to make it worthwhile for generations to come. That's why we have assembled the world's largest collection of more than 100,000 items related to computing, going all the way back to quipu sticks and the ancient abacus and all the way forward to the iPad. It's why we have recorded nearly 500 oral histories of the men and women who have made history here in Silicon Valley and around the world. It's why we have our Fellows program, the 52 portraits of which are collected on the wall just outside this auditorium. They comprise some of the greatest figures in the history of technology. It's why we undertake 20 to 30 programs like this every year, all of which are fully viewable on our branded YouTube channel. It's why we're the only major museum in the world with an internet history program and a forthcoming area of our Revolution exhibit dedicated to the web and networking. And finally, it's why we have a vast digital museum at computerhistory.org, where among other things, we release the original source code for MacPaint and QuickDraw for the world to see for the first time yesterday morning, something our friends at Apple have, at least to this point, permitted only us to do. Those of us in this branch of contemporary history do better when we stick together. That's one reason why we're so delighted to be associated with David Kirkpatrick, author of the fascinating book that we're exploring tonight, and Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, who just a few hours ago announced that the Facebook community has now exceeded this milestone, 500 million users. We may not know how history will ultimately write the Facebook story, but two things are certain. David Kirkpatrick has made an excellent start, and his help and support was clearly instrumental. Mark's help and support was clearly instrumental to David's exceptional storytelling. All of David's experience is on full display in the Facebook Effect. 20 years as a senior writer at Fortune magazine, author of the Fortune column Fast Forward, founder, host, and program director of the Brainstorm conference series, founder of the Techonomy conference kicking off next month at Lake Tahoe. Conducting this conversation between David and Mark tonight is NPR's Guy Raz, weekend host of All Things Considered, one of the most sought-after interviewers in the business. He has interviewed everyone from Ariel Sharon to Eminem. This marks a return trip to the museum for Guy, who kicked off the Net at 40 series in the spring by interviewing ARPANET pioneer Bob Taylor. If tonight is as freewheeling and candid as his evening with Bob Taylor was, we are in for a real treat. You can contribute to that with the question cards that are on your chair. You can write your questions down. We'll be collecting them for Guy once we get a little further into the program. Please join me now in welcoming Mark, David, and Guy to the stage for tonight's program.
Okay, well, thank you very much, John. And I'm going to dispense with any opening remarks and dive right into the questions, because I think many of us here have many questions for both Mark and David. The first question is for you, David. And I just wanted you to give us a sense of what you mean when you talk about the Facebook effect. What is that?
Well, it's a generic kind of concept about all of the ways in which this massive social phenomenon, social and technological phenomenon, is changing the world. And I talk about politics, government, business, marketing, identity, privacy, social life, and other areas. Really, when you get to 500 million people on any system, there are enormous ramifications, and Facebook was designed from the beginning in order to have certain ramifications that it's quite successfully having.
Mark Zuckerberg, obviously, congratulations are in order because of the announcement today on your Facebook page, right? Was it your Facebook page that I saw it, or was it a blog post?
Yeah, we posted a number of places.
Saw the video. 500 million users. That's double the number of users you had about a year ago. Give me a sense of a Facebook moment over the past year that has wowed you, something that happened that you thought, the thing that I created made that happen.
Well, the thing that we did to commemorate now having 500 million people is we just assembled this collection of stories that the people who use our service have written into us over the years. And I can go give a few, but I mean, they're really kind of amazing and very varied, right? I mean, everything from the guy who's the last prime minister of Denmark found basically had a bunch of connections on his Facebook page, and they became his jogging buddies, right?
I was going to put that in my book, and I think I forgot. Yeah, that's a good story.
This is Anders Fogh Rasmussen, right?
There's a mayor in a city in Connecticut who found that one of his constituents needed a kidney, and then went and donated his own kidney. The stories that we hear from people range from these kind of incredibly profound things like that to just really kind of day-to-day things where people are just trying to stay connected with their friends and family and the people that they care about, and now have a way to do that that's a lot easier than anything that they had before.
Do you ever get freaked out about how powerful this tool that you invented has become, that those things can happen? Do you ever think?
Well, it's people doing them, right? I think like what we've really built is a platform, right? I mean, we're not building a system where people are donating organs, right? I mean, we're donating a system where people can stay connected with the people that they want to. And there's always been the ability for people to sit down face to face and have a conversation, right? I mean, for a while, there's been the ability for people to call someone up no matter where they are. I mean, it's been gotten a lot cheaper recently, but to be able to have kind of a synchronous one-way conversation with people who you're willing to call up, right, and who you have that level of comfort with. But until recently, there hasn't really been a good system for you to keep in touch with all of the other people who are in your life, who you meet at some point, who are important or were important and you want to keep up with, but you don't have a way to talk to on a day-to-day basis, and you wouldn't go out of your way to call, and you would never sit down with them in person. And I mean, it's the power that's unlocked from that is really what we're seeing here, right? And when you can build up all of the value of those latent connections and keep them open, that this is the type of stuff that becomes possible. But it's because people want to do it on their own anyway. We're just kind of allowing people to have that the ability to do those things.
And all that is what I would call the Facebook effect. I mean, it was designed to be a viral platform for communication. Mm. And you know, I think it is a good point that Mark just made, that Facebook is literally just a platform. It has no content of its own whatsoever. Everything there is created by its members. And I think this viral system that Mark effectively designed quite consciously, where information flows, especially because of the news feed, from person to person with amazing efficiency, if it's of interest, that is sort of the root of the effect that it's at kind of the name of my book.
David, in John's introduction, he mentioned Bob Taylor, who was on this stage, actually in your seat, about 2 or 3 months ago. He is not an international celebrity. Most people in the world have not heard of Bob Taylor. Far more know who Mark Zuckerberg is. He is arguably the father of computer-to-computer communication. Okay, and you mention him in your book, which, by the way, is a great, not just a primer on Facebook, but a fun book to read. So
thank you.
Wanted to let you know that. where does Mark Zuckerberg, in your view, fit into the history of the internet or the history of communication?
Well, I think that anybody who's created a system that gets to 500 million people, particularly in 6 years, deserves a fairly great prominence in the history of innovators in communication. The world is changing so fast now that it's harder to put someone in the hierarchy the way we might have once felt comfortable doing. So, you know, is Mark more important than Alexander Graham Bell, or equally important? I don't have a clue. I mean, he doesn't think so. I mean, but, you know, we'll find out over time. But, you know, I mean, Facebook will not last as long as the telephone did, I can assure you of that. So we'll have to make our judgments more rapidly about these matters.
There you go. You heard it here first.
I'm not saying it's not a great thing, Mark, but it's not going to let... telephone's been around for like 100 years. You think Facebook will be here in 100 years, literally? You really do?
I don't know, but I don't know how long telephones are going to be around for.
No, I mean...
What was it?
No, that I agree with. But I mean, I'm talking about from its inception to today. Do you think Facebook has the prospect of 100 years? I mean, literally, but this is a question I get all the time. You know, what's Facebook going to be in 10 years? And I always say, I cannot even begin to answer any question like that about any internet business. Do you think it's a reasonable assumption that Facebook will be a strong and powerful business in 10 years? Or even, I mean, what do you think? Is that a given?
Well, 10 years, I hope so.
10 years, yeah. Okay. What about 40 years?
I mean, it's like, I think that these things change over time. So, I mean, I think that, you know, if you look at some of the great technology companies, they made a huge change in the world and then transitioned into great long-term businesses, right? So, I mean, companies like IBM are maybe not kind of at the forefront right now of consumer technology, but are still great companies long after being the massive innovators in their space. So, I mean, I think that these companies can be around for a very long period of time. But I certainly think that the trend that we're operating on now of helping people share information, which is really something that, you know, going back 20 years ago, most people in society did not have the power to do. I mean, the internet has really brought that about. Now everyone can share their opinions and information about themselves or what's going on around them, and that's a new thing. And I think that's the trend that we're hoping to help push forward. I don't know, I think that's going to be one of the most transformative trends in society over the next 10, 15, I mean, who knows how long.
But could I just say one of the,
sure.
The fact that a system could have grown to 500 million in a little over 6 years does suggest that the pace of change is truly accelerating.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, so something else is, many other something else's are going to come along, and burgeon with incredible speed. So, I mean, this is what I always say, but tell me if I'm right about that. I always say that you take as a mantra, only the paranoid survive. And one of the reasons why you make all these changes that affect privacy and product is because you are literally afraid of the Foursquares and the Twitters and the other innovators, and you do not want to be rendered irrelevant, and you want Facebook to remain a vital, cutting-edge service, and you know that requires constant change.
Well, I like to think we're a little more proactive than that.
What do you mean?
I mean, I don't think that the changes are motivated out of fear as much as wanting to help move the world forward.
Okay.
Let me ask you about this idea of moving the world forward, because with this incredible product you offer, I'm sure there isn't a person in this room who doesn't use it. I obviously use it. You also have a very powerful database. I believe the largest database of personal information that exists outside the realm of government, right? Facebook, if it were a country, would be the third most populous in the world. I mean, you are the head of a country. I mean, one out of 14.
Don't tell that.
There's a lot of assertions going on up here that I don't agree with.
One out of 14 humans on planet Earth is now has a Facebook profile.
It doesn't make us a country.
It does. It's 500 million does. It's an extraordinary number of people. Do you remind yourself daily of the responsibility that puts in your hands? You're 26 years old. You are a young guy. I know that you're reminded of that all the time, and I'm sorry to do it again, but you are. And it's an immense amount of responsibility. How do you handle that responsibility?
I mean, I think the main thing is we've just assembled a team at the company that has this tremendous sense of purpose for what we're doing, right? So, I mean, it goes back to some of the questions that you were asking about building companies, where a lot of the people at Facebook, including myself, never thought we would be a part of a company, right? I mean, I started Facebook, and a lot of the people who joined early on, I think still join the company, are doing it just because they believe in what we're doing, and they believe that if you can give people tools to share information and to stay connected with the people that they care about, that just opens up all these possibilities. And then if you can build a development platform on top of which all these other people can build social applications, then you can create a whole lot of new experiences that weren't possible before. But I think it's that kind of clarity around what we're trying to do that I think is what gives us the ability to keep on doing like these rounds of innovation instead of, the type of stuff that you're talking about, right? Like becoming a company. Right?
People have a very hard time believing that about Facebook. That's a fact. I mean, they really, and to be honest, I don't think you do as good a job communicating as you could. The scope of the vision and the passion that you and your colleagues, as you describe, share. And it's one aspect of my book that people challenge me on everywhere I go. They cannot believe that Facebook isn't doing it for the money, for the ad marketplace, et cetera, et cetera. Could I just follow up with a specific question about this? You know, because one of the things that I know about you is you love product, you love engineering. You know, what you would rather be doing is sitting at a terminal talking to the product team and the engineers to make the product better, right?
Doing that later tonight.
I know you will. So, probably every night. But Facebook is, as Guy is implying, at sort of a turning point where its scale is requiring a new sort of responsibility on its part. And one of the questions that I have for you is, you know, do you really want to be the leader of a company that requires this constant interface with government and regulators around the world in order to, you know, keep explaining what it is you're doing? Because they are pushing back, as you well know.
And quite understandably, because it's something you've described as a utility.
So, I mean, the way that I think about this is, you know, a lot of people have asked me this question of, okay, now that Facebook has 500 million people, or is nearing 500 million people before today, you know, a lot of the job has become, you know, in addition to building things, building out a team, communicating externally now, and kind of dealing with a lot of these different constituents that we wouldn't have had to deal with when we had 10 million people using our products.
Right.
You know, those are things that are typically you see with a mature company, right? And I think the way that we think about this is that if we thought that Facebook was a mature company and was anywhere near the end of its trajectory in terms of being able to innovate or or that the product was near maturity in terms of its development, if people were sharing on the order of the amount of information that we think that they'll end up sharing, then, you know, maybe those things would overwhelm how fun it was to build this. But we just don't think we're anywhere near the beginning. I mean, instead, anywhere near the end. What we've seen is, you know, there's this massive trend on the internet towards there being all kinds of information available, right? I mean, when I was growing up, Google came out when I was in middle school, right? So, I mean, there are these search engines. It's like, so growing up, and like every year there's like some new cool thing, right? So it's like one year, it's like, all right, there's a search engine. Now you can look for anything you want. Or another year, it's like, all right, now there's Wikipedia. You can like get reference material on anything you want. Now there's Napster. You can get any song you want, right? And there's like all these different services. But the thing that I think is most interesting to people is other people. Right, so I think it makes sense in a way that Facebook is by far the most engaging app that's been built online to date. Right, I mean, people who use Facebook spend much more time with Facebook per person than any other app. So what we did for the first few years of building the company from 2004 to 2007 was, with really a small group of people, we just started building versions of products that were designed from the ground up to be built around people, right? So we built things like photos and groups and events. And what we found was, you know, each of these projects was built with a group of maybe two or three people, right? Because at the time, the company was 20 or 50 people, or 20 to 50 people in that range. We built this photos application that didn't have a lot of the features of other photos applications, right? There were no high-resolution photos. You couldn't print. I mean, early on, you couldn't even reorder the photos in an album. But what it had was it was built from the ground up so that as soon as you shared a photo, all your friends had it. And it turned out that that feature was more important than every other feature
combined.
Yeah,
the tagging of people was the key feature.
And the same thing for groups and the same thing for events. So what we have now is Facebook photos are used, I think, 3, 4, 5 times more than all other photo services on the internet combined, right? And a similar story for groups and a similar story for events. So then we hit this turning point in 2007 where we said, okay, we think that we can take basically any application and by building it to be around people, which are the thing that people care the most about, if we did that, then we think we could build a more engaging version of any application out there. But because there are so many applications that need to get built, rather than trying to build these all ourselves with teams of 2 or 3 people where we're not building all the features that whole companies could, let's build a development platform. Right? And that's what we've been focused on since then. And what we've seen since then is, I mean, just in the most recent release, right, we built this thing called social plugins where you can just, any site can take a line of HTML, copy and paste it, and drop it into their site. So for example, CNN.com, right, has this. And you can look at any news article, and you can see which of your friends like that article without CNN ever knowing who you are or who your friends are. Right? It's a really cool experience. And what sites that have used these social plugins have seen is that the engagement that they've gotten from people using Facebook has gone up by about 2x, the referrals from Facebook. And that's just a simple integration. So you can imagine that people are doing a lot deeper things are getting even stronger results, right? And the first one that I think we're really seeing of an industry getting completely transformed is games. I think games are often an early indicator in a new platform. We kind of saw that with the iPhone. There were games that took
off.
It used
to be porn, but okay, go ahead.
Well, fair. I mean, I think early PC, there were a lot of games. Facebook, games are really one of the first things that took off. And there were all these companies. There's Zynga, there's Playfish, there's Playdom, Crowdstar, a whole kind of new set of companies. And I mean, these are real companies. I mean, Playfish was acquired for almost $400 million last year. Zynga, on the secondary private markets, has a market cap that's about half of that of EA with an eighth of the number of employees. I mean, that's disruption, right? And so I think what we're going to see is, so this is year one, right, in terms of this industry is kind of the first one that's getting transformed. But I just think over the next few years, we're going to see it in every industry. Mm-hmm. And so that's exciting, right? So now back to your question about is it okay to spend some time interfacing with the media and governments and all that? Yeah, if you get to do that.
So, but do you? But
let me, David. Let me just interject you for a moment.
Guy is the moderator.
I want to get back, Mark, to this idea of the question that I asked you, and this idea of this immense database. And I don't mean to present it as some kind of nefarious thing that you're sitting atop, but we know that Facebook has this incredible ability to say to an advertiser, you want to target 26-year-old women who like Bikram yoga, and we can get you there, which is amazing. Now, I trust you, and you, trust is your currency, and you're telling us to trust you, and we do, let's say. But what happens in 10 years, or 20 years, or 30 years, when you're not, let's say, in charge of the company, or your power is altered in the company, and somebody in the company decides to take that data about us, the information that we have volunteered and handed over, about our likes and dislikes, the music we listen to, our birth dates, who we're married to, what our kids' names are, and sells that information. What kind of guarantee is there that that won't happen?
Well, I just think it would be the stupidest thing we could possibly do.
But so, but how
what,
can
so you not be CEO or what?
I mean, no, I didn't say that.
How do you guarantee that?
I mean, the internet, I mean, we're talking about how technology moves so quickly, right? And I think it's really easy to say that there's all this information that Facebook has or something like that, but really what Facebook is today is this engine in this community of people sharing a lot of information, right, on a day-to-day basis.
Except the information is in a centralized...
Well, actually, I think that that's maybe a misconception, because the rate of information that people are sharing is increasing so quickly that, I mean, the nature of any sort of exponential growth, right, is that the amount of content that people had in the system last year will be just a fraction of the content that's in the system at the end of this year, and it's going to keep on growing, and not only are more people signing up to use the service because they want to stay connected with friends and family, but every day that goes by, each person on the service on average is sharing more information into the system. So here's an analogy that I think is actually pretty apt for this. Think about Wikipedia, right? Wikipedia has this policy where any person can go download all of Wikipedia and fork it and create a rival encyclopedia. And you know, some people have taken some Wikipedia content and tried to do that, but no one ever creates anything that's anywhere comes near close to quality of Wikipedia. The reason for that is because the real thing that Wikipedia is isn't an encyclopedia. It's a community of people that build encyclopedias. So you can copy the encyclopedia somewhere else, but you're not copying the community. Now, Facebook is very similar, because we have all these open APIs, right, and we're building a platform, like I was just talking about, and people can go and they can take all their information anywhere else. What Facebook is isn't a set of information today, it's a community of people who are using Facebook to stay connected and share information. They're only going to do that as long as they trust us and as long as we're the best tool that exists to do that.
So just to confirm, if they were to decide to leave it, that data would be wiped out.
People can use the API, they can take their information to all these other services. Not only are we okay with that, we're encouraging it. That's the whole platform strategy that we're embarking on, is by allowing people to do that, we're allowing much more innovation in other apps that we would never get around to building.
I mean, we know that for many people is not a choice any longer, because so many people have come to depend on Facebook. It is not just a cultural phenomenon, it is an indispensable part of many people's lives. You've described Facebook as a utility. Like the electric company, like the phone company. Two questions. Should it be regulated? Why shouldn't it be regulated like utility? And if it is a utility, couldn't you make the argument that it's a monopoly?
He doesn't mean that when he says utility.
So, well, we've
but
talked
he should
about
not use the word utility, because everybody thinks what you think.
I got
about.
You. Okay, well, good.
So here's how we started off talking
utility.
About this.
Because
you
utilities
know,
are regulated.
When we got started, everyone compared us to MySpace. Right, and the big difference that we saw between ourselves and MySpace was that people used MySpace because it was cool and because it was fun. And people ask us this question all the time. What's going to happen when Facebook is no longer cool? Right, I mean, it's been around for 6 years, where things don't stay cool forever. My answer to that question is that our goal was never to build something cool. Right, it was to build something useful. And you know, something that's cool is not going to be around for a long time. Something that's useful is around for a very long time, potentially, if it continues to be useful. So to me, when I say utility, that's what I mean, is that we're trying to provide people with utility, not have something that's kind of that's fun. In terms of regulation, I mean, we get regulated by users, right? I mean,
And is that enough, you think?
I think like there's plenty of dialogue around what we do and important issues that are going on the internet. I think we've shown that we listen carefully to that, and that influences our policies and the products that we make. And you know, like I was just saying, we support this open platform and we want to design it so that people can go and they can take their information and go to any other service that they want.
Mark, in David's book, you're quoted as saying, having two identities for yourself is an example of a lack of integrity, which I think is an interesting quote. And it goes on to explain that people shouldn't have a different persona, present a different persona to their coworkers and a different persona to their friends. So say, you know, I behave in a certain way around my family and behave a slightly different way around my coworkers. You would argue that there's a lack of integrity there. I'm wondering why you think that is. I mean, do you think that we should all interact in the exact same way with everybody we know?
No, I think that was just a sentence that I said. I mean, like, that wasn't like some long thought out argument.
I was worried you were going to say that.
No, I mean, if you think about what is the definition of integrity, I think it literally is being the same thing in different faces.
I mean, are you the same person right now that you are when you're with your friends drinking beers?
I actually, probably, yeah. I mean,
fair enough.
Same, you know, awkward person. I think that is the definition of integrity, right? Is like the dictionary definition is having the same face for not saying one thing to someone and saying a different thing to someone else. So I think actually by definition, if you are presenting one face to another, to one set of people and another to another, that is a lack of integrity. I wasn't making a value judgment on whether that's...
So that's when you talk to somebody who studied Greek. Yeah, go on. Yeah.
But I mean, the Janus head, right? But you do talk a lot about this idea of... I want to explore this idea of transparency with both of you because I think it's fascinating. And I'm interested in this idea of transparency because there's different ways of looking at it. David Brooks in the New York Times writes about this a lot. He talks about transparency in government and how paradoxically it has created a climate where fewer Americans actually trust government. The more transparent government is, fewer people trust it. You really push this idea of openness and transparency. What do you think it'll lead to? Why do you think people should be willing? What do you think it will lead to? Uh-huh. Why do you think people should be willing to reveal details about their lives, open themselves up to the world? I mean, why not keep some things private and personal?
Well, I think people will always keep some things private, right? I think the big difference between now and 20 or 30 years ago is now everyone at least has the tools, if they want to share things. But a core tenet of Facebook has always been control. Right from the very first version of the site, we built privacy controls that every single piece of information that you put on the site, you could say exactly who saw it. And one of the challenges that we've had as the company has grown is trying to make it so that scales, because now people are sharing way more things than they were at the beginning, and we want to make sure that they continue to have controls for each thing, but we don't want to have 1,000 different controls that they touch. So that's one of the big areas that we've been modifying and innovating on recently, is just now, you know, there's just one master control. You know, you go to your mm-hmm. privacy page, you can say in two clicks, I want all the content I share on a day-to-day basis to be visible to only my friends.
And clearly that was a response to the criticism and that has dissipated by and large.
But going back to the question, question, go for it.
No, please, please.
Control, when people feel comfortable sharing information, and they feel like they have control over what they share and who they share it with, people become comfortable sharing more things, right? So for example, if I only could choose to share my mobile phone number with everyone on Facebook, I wouldn't do it. But because I can do it with only my friends, I do it, right? So now there's more ability for me to actually share those things. What I think that creates over time is there are these opportunities for people to share more things, and a lot of people are realizing that, hey, it's really valuable for me to share more things in certain contexts, and that leads to this kind of broader social change where I think now there's more transparency, right? I mean, more people are blogging, more people are using Facebook to share more stuff, more people are using Twitter, more people are posting stuff on YouTube. That means that if we want, there's more out there that we can go look at and research and understand what's going on with the people around us. And I just think that leads to broader kind of empathy, understanding, just a lot of kind of good core human mm-hmm. things that make society function better.
David has written a very interesting chapter on privacy in the book, which I found very useful. And did you want to
Well, I was going to say, first of all, I totally buy what Mark said. I mean, the reason people put so much data on Facebook is because from day one, it was the first place that ever existed on the internet that had privacy controls. It was the only place anybody had ever put their real name and their cell phone number and their email address, because they could control who saw their data. And I think one of the reasons this privacy issue is so fraught for Facebook and leads to so much discussion and controversy is because people have entrusted an enormous amount of data to it, and I think they're worried that maybe their trust was misplaced. And this is where I think Guy's question before is a legitimate one about what would happen if you weren't in charge, you know, and there is this huge mass of data in there. But rather than have you answer that again, I would like to ask you another question, which is closely related and very related to what you just said. My own personal feeling, and I spent a lot of time talking to people about Facebook, it's like all I've been doing for the last 6 or 8 weeks, is because I've been promoting my book, and I just came from Kansas City last night. So why doesn't Facebook make it much, much even easier than it is to set up group functionality? So you can control like the family, the best friends, the high school friends, the church friends, the friends you just friended on Facebook because you couldn't say no. Each one of those is a different category for whom you want different visibility into you, and you want to see different visibility into them. And it seems to me you would get more sharing mm-hmm. if that functionality was radically improved. You've got it. It
yeah.
does exist,
yeah, no, you're
but
right.
it's
you're
not
right.
easy
you're
enough
right.
to use,
you're
and
right.
people
right.
don't even know it's there.
You're right.
So how do you deal with that? You're going
to
help?
Well, we need to do better.
You're
going to
improve
that? Yeah, I mean, this is one of the core areas that we need to work on now, and that we are working on, is now people have all these different groups of friends, and it used to be that saying, I want to share with my friends, was a good, that meant private, right? Like, I don't want to share with everyone, I want to share with my friends. But now I think more and more people have subgroups of friends that they want to be able to share different things with subgroups.
Yeah.
That I think is a really important case, and we're cutting at it in a lot of different ways to get there, and hopefully soon we'll have more to talk about.
I mean, to what extent does the success of Facebook depend on a majority of users choosing the least restrictive settings, privacy settings?
Oh, I don't really think that matters much. I think the key is that people can share with whoever they want, right? And that people, I mean, it goes back to the point I was making before with Wikipedia. What we have is a community of people here who are this engine for sharing and connecting. The key is that they could do that in whatever way that they want, right? So I think that the question that you're talking about of being able to segment it into saying, okay, here's my family, here's my work friends, here are my school friends, here are my high school friends, whatever it is, that will be really valuable to do. But I think that kind of gets to one of the core things in building Facebook is that designing products that do these things simply is pretty hard, right? And I think that's one of the big innovations that we've had is, I mean, earlier on, you guys, like we were watching that video, I mean, we're not designing microprocessors, but what we are doing is designing very simple ways for people to have social interactions that are very nuanced. And you know, I think it's a lot easier in a lot of these cases to point to what a problem is than to come up with what is a solution that people will actually use. So let me give you an example of something that we did that actually didn't work that well. Our first cut at trying to help people segment stuff, segment their friend list into groups, was this functionality that we call friend lists. Right? It basically, you can go and you can create a list of people, and you can put whatever friends you want, whatever lists. You can say, okay, here are my high school friends, here are my college friends, here are my work friends, whatever. It turns out that most people don't want to go and create lists of things. Right, I mean, most people would not ever even have a friend list to begin with, except for the fact that the act of creating friends is a very nice social interaction, right? I mean, you get to reach out to someone and say, hey, you know, I like you, will you be my friend? And then the person can say, like, yeah, right? And, I mean, that's nice, right? I mean, there's, like, this nice feeling that goes along with that. And I think that's why people do it, right? I mean, people aren't on Facebook because they want to list their friends. Right, so that's what designing the product is about, right? Is kind of coming up with these ways that kind of align people, what people are trying to do, which is stay connected, with building out this platform, which is going to help them stay connected even more when you can do more things with it. So I think everyone agrees, no doubt, we would be in a better place and people would be able to share more if everyone magically had these subgroups created. I think that there is a solution to it, and we need to get there, mm-hmm. but it's hard. And that's one of the big things that we work on.
You know, this is a passionate subject for Sean Parker, as you know. I mean, he believes that you should, every time you see a name on Facebook, you should have an easy drop-down menu, and you mm-hmm. should be able to put people into a group based on, you know, your groups, just based, every time you see the name, shove them into a different group, change the group, or whatever. But you know, you said something before that I think is really interesting, and I'd like to just quickly, I know it's sort of a dual interview here, but anyway. You said it doesn't matter whether people use the everyone privacy setting that much, right? You made this change in December where you sort of forcibly caused people to use the everyone privacy setting and it led to a lot of controversy and you undid that later. Are you saying that when you undid it, you didn't regret it and feel like, oh, we sort of lost the ability to do things I wanted to do? I mean, I personally was not happy that I had always had my friends list friends only and you undid that. Now you've given me the ability to go back to the way I like it. But, you know, how important was it to you to try to make it the way that you tried to make it?
So honestly, a lot of what we were trying to do was just create a very simple experience, right? We don't want to have a million different settings that people have to touch, because if they do, then they won't, right? And then they won't use the system because then they don't feel like they can control their stuff. So we tried to create a simple system for this, based on the settings that we actually saw that people were using. And we made some mistakes, and we got it wrong. And it turns out that even if only 0.1% of users use a setting, they really care about that setting.
And so
it's fine, right? I mean, but that's our job, is to try to balance that. We make a lot of these trade-offs. I hope more often than not we get them right. Sometimes we make mistakes. We always listen. We try to make sure that when people have feedback, that we take that into account, and when it's real user feedback, right? Not just some things that are getting kind of a lot of attention. But you know, I think the reason why we made a lot of the changes is because we look at how people use the site, right? I mean, and the site has evolved a lot over time. It started off as this college thing, right? I mean, I built the first version when I was in my dorm room at Harvard. And the way that the site worked early on was you shared with the people around you in your college community and your friends. So it always had this element of it was your friends, but it was also the people around you, right? Because I mean, you wanted to share with maybe the people who were in your classes at school, or the people who you were in a club with who weren't your friends yet, right? And that was really valuable. Now, as we got out of college and more people started signing up, we found that there weren't as good proxies in society as a college for like the social circle that surrounded your whole community. So we tried other things, like the city around you, right? And that worked pretty well. But then we were growing so quickly that what happened was we couldn't actually keep up, and we couldn't actually provision a city for each geographic area. So what we ended up with, especially early on when we didn't have a lot of international growth, was we had these kind of crazy situations where a whole country would be a network, right? So Germany was a network. India was one network. China was a network.
So everyone in those countries could effectively see everybody's info.
Yeah, exactly. Now, the interesting thing is that those users were more engaged on the site than people who could only see and communicate with the people around them in college. So in the US, we almost had this completely different experience, right? Where a lot of us have these college networks. We have work networks, or we have networks for our companies. And that's been our experience. It's been a lot tighter, and we enjoy that, even though, ironically, it's led us to use the site less on average. Whereas internationally, where now 70% of our users are outside of the US, they are actually getting a huge amount of value out of sharing in that way and having those be the settings. So we decided, okay, well, going forward for new users, let's do something that's more like that. So that's what we did. When we got feedback on that people wanted to make sure that they could tweak it more easily if they weren't happy with those settings, then we kind of holed up in a room for a few weeks and we built that, right? We built this one control where now you go to your privacy page and there's just one control, and you know, you can click twice and have all your content set to friends and you're good. But we really listened at what people use, how people use the site, right? Because people are the site. So we listen to what people say when they write into us. But we also listen to what they're actually doing, and we look at the data of how people are using the site, and we try to make informed decisions based on that.
Mark, let me move away from the privacy issue for a moment. We still have lots of questions for you, and I'm sure there are lots of questions out there as well. But I want to ask you about Apple. And I want to ask you about how much of an impact Apple has on how you are thinking about calibrating your products. As you're aware, many people are using Facebook on mobile devices increasingly, myself included. You cannot right now, for example, upload a video you take with your iPhone directly to Facebook. As more and more people start to use Facebook on mobile devices, particularly Apple devices, will you start to alter your products to accommodate those users?
Well, I think in a way we already do. I mean, we have an iPhone app, which is specific to the iPhone, which more than 50% of people who have iPhones have.
But the thing I'm talking about, for example, uploading video, and obviously Apple has this issue, I think is an understatement, with Adobe. So how do you sort of, what do you do about that?
We do the best we can.
You stay diplomatic.
I mean, it's a great platform, right? And a lot of people like using it. It is an interesting challenge developing things today, because in 2004, when I got started with Facebook, it was very clear what we were going to build. We were going to build a website, right? We weren't building desktop software. We weren't building something for a phone, right? The desktop software was the past. Phones were too far off in the future and not a mature enough platform yet. Build something for the web. I think there are all these opportunities and challenges because you have a web version, you have an iPhone version, you have an Android version, you have an iPad version, you have a mobile web version for phones that have touch interfaces, you have a mobile web version for cheaper feature phones which don't have like rich browsing interfaces, and it actually ends up being really challenging to develop for all these environments, but it reaches a lot of people. You know, so I mean, it's how people want to use the service, so we spend a lot of time doing it.
In a recent article in the New York Times, Miguel Helft wrote an article that said Google regards Facebook as its biggest threat today. Do you think that you threaten Google?
You know, it's interesting that people talk about that so much, because if you think about it on its face, we don't do any of the same products. Right, I mean, it's like they do search, we don't do search. Right? I mean, they have email, we don't do email. We have maps, yeah, but they do more direct response advertising and we do more brand advertising. So even that is quite different. So I don't know. There's one perspective on Google, which is that Google's market cap is greater than that of all other internet companies put together. So from that perspective, they could see any growing company as a threat. But from our perspective, they don't have to lose for us to win, right? I mean, more people are using Facebook every day, and that doesn't mean people are using Google less, right? So what we're trying to do is just make it so that people can stay connected with their friends and the people around them better. That's just not a service that anyone else currently provides. We think it's important, so we're going to try to do it as best as we can.
I just wanted to make a point on the Apple issue. You know, the Facebook app is so central to the success of the iPhone that if Facebook were to determine that the way Apple was handling video was truly problematic for Facebook, in my opinion, they would have more leverage than anybody probably on the planet to argue for a change in the way it's handled. I mean, I firmly believe the iPhone would not have become nearly the phenomenon that it is, and I have one, if Facebook app wasn't on it. And it's a huge percentage of total application use on the iPhone. I'm sure if any of us heard the number, which is a highly closely held secret, it would be astonishing how high a percentage of usage it is. So Mark is not enthralled to Steve Jobs, is what I'm saying. I think Facebook has extensive leverage if that needs to exercise it. I mean, I doubt if Mark would confirm his opinion on that, but that's my opinion. And I do know, isn't it true you're spending a lot of you've gotten to know Jobs pretty well recently, haven't you? Haven't you spent some time talking to him lately?
Yeah, he's great.
Yeah. I think he spends a fair amount of time talking to him.
No, I mean, I wouldn't say a fair amount. I spend all my time building products, but, yeah.
What do you make of...
There's that ambassadorial responsibility coming up again, you know.
Speaking of competitors or potential competitors, what do you make of these groups of people who are working on open source social networks like Facebook, where data would not be central, would not be stored in a central location, diaspora, for example, you've got to be aware of this.
I donated money to them.
There you go. Reading David's book, it reminded me, and reading about how you guys created Facebook, it seems like there's a lot of that kind of energy in diaspora. Does it worry you? B, does it remind you of yourself three or four or five years ago?
I mean, I think it's cool. Early on at Facebook, we had this project, Wirehog, that I think you actually cover a bit in your book.
A bit, yes.
And I don't know, I actually haven't read the book. And
he doesn't like, he's not.
I don't read stuff.
Wait, are you going to watch the movie, though?
Probably not.
Right, that's what I thought.
But,
we'll get there.
I mean, so early on, you know, so we talked about a little before about how photos ended up being such an important part of the Facebook ecosystem. And from early on, our users were requesting that we add more photos to the site. And really early on, we had no money, right? And hosting photos is expensive. So we figured, okay, let's build a decentralized application that can plug into Facebook. That's a web server that looks a lot like what these guys are doing. Where people can host their own photos, and wouldn't that be great, right? And I think it just turned out that, at least in our implementation, we couldn't get it to work as well as we wanted, and it turned out that us hosting the photos application and running that ourselves was a much better solution once we had the resources to be able to do that. But I just think it's cool that all these people are trying all these different things, right? I mean, I think some things, some technical systems become decentralized, some become centralized, right? I think we can all probably agree that it would be pretty bad if the search index were split onto 10 different sites and you had to search in a lot of different places. I mean, that's a service that I think makes a lot of sense to have centralized. But, we okay?
Yeah, no problem.
All right. And so I don't know, I just think it's cool to see what all these people are doing, right? I mean, people are building great apps that use the social graph through Facebook, like games, and all these other applications. People are building other kind of alternative structures to mapping out the graph that I think are cool innovations. It's all cool.
Mark, I, in the spirit of openness and transparency, that obviously you, I do have to ask you some questions that you probably don't want to talk about, but there is a Facebook fan page. 5,000 users have signed up to the fan page for a film called The Social Network. It has a Facebook page. You know that it
I
is
have
a,
more than that for my book.
We all know that this is a telling, we'll just say a kind of telling or an imagined telling of an imagined history of Facebook. First thing, do you plan to see the film?
I mean, probably not. I generally I don't read stuff or watch stuff.
Do you have any anxiety about it coming out? Do you have any worries or concerns? Is it annoying?
You know, honestly, I wish that when people tried to do journalism or write stuff about Facebook, that they at least tried to get it right. So, I mean, that's why, having not read all of your book, and I read a part of it when you sent it to me, I at least appreciate the effort that you put in terms of spending like all those hours and days talking to dozens of people in the ecosystem around us, at least trying to understand what's going on, right? So, I mean, if I read your book, I probably wouldn't agree with everything, but at least there's the sense that it's serious journalism, right? And at the same time, I mean, there's another book that was written about us that was written by a fiction writer, and these guys were, you know, decided to have this idea, all right, let's make a movie about Facebook. They had two choices of books to base it on.
I mean, just
based
in his,
it on the fiction book.
In his defense, I mean, he did try to interview you for his book.
The reason why we didn't participate is because it was very clear that it was fiction from the beginning, right? And we talked to him about that, and he basically told us, you know, what I'm most interested in is telling the most interesting story, right? And we want to make sure that we never participate in something like that, so then someone can take something that's really fictional and say, and we talked to Mark Zuckerberg for this, right? So, you know, I think it's clear that it's fiction. All the book reviews of that book from people who know it say that it's fiction. The movie is based on the book. I don't really know how much else there is to say about it.
Do you wish that Justin Timberlake was playing your character?
Yeah, that really would not make a difference one way or another. You know, the guy who was playing me, his cousin works at Facebook.
Oh, really?
And
And he still has a job, right?
He is currently the lead designer on Newsfeed. And and I meet with him, you know, every week to go through the next version of what we're building. And I mean, he's a cool guy, right? And he's really talented. And you know, I mean, I'm sure all the people involved in the movie are talented, right? So that's cool. But I mean, the movie's fiction. I think that's really the most important
thing
to
leave. And you'll just sort of let it go and hopefully it'll pass.
Yeah, I mean, I really believe that all that we can do is focused on building the best thing. And that over time, people will remember us for what we build, right? And not what anyone said about us all along the way. And I mean, maybe that's idealistic. I mean, maybe I have to think that. But that's what I choose to focus on, right? And what I want to keep the company focused on. And but I think that means, you know, you can't just say I want to ignore things that sound bad or that are kind of made up about us. I think it's really important if you're going to have that perspective that you also don't pay too much attention when people are saying really good things about you either. So I mean, just we have a really strong sense at the company of what we're trying to do, and that's what guides us.
I mean, do you sometimes wish you could just sort of drop out and escape for a moment and get away from the inevitable celebrity that comes with being who you are and what you created? Do you sometimes just think, God, I just wish I could, like, shut it off for a day or 2 days or a week?
Well, I mean, I can. It's called, you know, hanging out with my friends at home, right?
But
or
you
their
can't.
Homes
I mean, you'd be recognized anywhere here.
Not in my house. I mean, like, you can't come to my house. right, and I mean, a lot of my friends now, my closest friends, are people who I've known throughout the whole experience, or people who I've gotten to know by working with them really closely over the past few years, right? I mean, as an example of one piece of fiction in the movie, I think that they somehow try to portray it as if I'm building Facebook to get girls.
Somehow, that's like the whole theme of the movie and the book.
I haven't read the book and whatever. The truth is, I've been dating the same girl since before I built Facebook, right? So, you know, like a lot of the people who have been through the story have been consistent throughout. You know, it's that core group of people who work on it, who care about it, who are your friends, who are really the important people, and you know that's what matters.
But also, it's a much bigger issue for Facebook. It's the issue of how media, books, movies change the image of Mark Zuckerberg and the company is a far smaller issue for them, in my opinion, than what governments and regulators are going to be saying and doing. And this is why I think this issue of, you know, do you really want to be out there meeting with David Cameron every week like you did the other day? That's what you're going to have to be doing, because whether you like it or not, I don't think the movie really matters in the grand scheme of things from a standpoint of Facebook's success or failure. I do think when you are maintaining all this identity information for people and you're getting into areas where governments feel very threatened and this issue of privacy is of such great concern in so many jurisdictions, this is a real issue. I think the movie is something of a distraction, and I honestly would like to hear more about how you think you're going to handle this issue. I mean, we've seen it with the privacy the Commissioner of Canada. You guys negotiated with them for a full year, and then she got mad again after you did the recent stuff. You know, and the EU is coming at you, and the Australian government's coming at you, and this is a real... You must think about that, don't you?
Yeah, I think that there are important dialogues to have. And, you know, I mean, there are all these folks that we work with, right? I mean, we work with, and we obviously mostly listen to what our users want, both in terms of what they do and what they tell us. We work with a whole set of nonprofit organizations who are the voice of users on privacy issues and security issues and things like that. And we interface with governments. And, you know, what I find more often than not is that all of these people are reasonable, right? And they all are doing what they're doing because they think it's good for the world, right? No one is coming at this with bad intentions. So I think the key is just to engage with all these people who are trying to have this real discourse around serious issues and try to come to the right issues, right? The internet isn't stopping. Right, so
but are you personally willing to engage in that to the degree? I think it's really going to be necessary for the CEO of Facebook, whether it's you or somebody else, to spend a very substantial percentage of their time doing that. And I wonder whether you want to do that. I mean, Larry and Sergey hired Eric Schmidt. And this is, I think, a question people ask me all the time. Are you going to hire that kind of a person? Because you really are a product guy, you know? I don't know whether you, I heard you did a great job with Cameron, by the way, and the whole cabinet. That's very cool. And maybe that is what you are going to want to do more of. And I'm not saying you can't succeed at convincing them of a lot of things you're talking about up here, but there are enormous misconceptions abroad about Facebook's reality and intentions. And when you are operating in literally every country on the planet, except for North Korea, China, and Cuba, and a few others, you know, you're going to have these issues coming at you day in and day out.
Yeah, and I think the strategy is as follows. I mean, we have a great team of people who are just top-notch in this field, right? I mean, we hire the best engineers and product folks. We also hire great policy thinkers because a big part of what we're doing is shaping internet policy, right? And how that plays out over time through our products, right? And like I said, we're not the last chapter in this. The internet will not stop, right? The internet is going to keep on going. These issues are going to be important issues. We want to make sure that we engage with the people who are having this debate to make sure that everyone gets to the right place. I think that the great people that we have on our team are actually going to be able to do a lot of it. Now, in terms of these companies, I don't know if the model of hiring a CEO to be externally facing while the people who are making a lot of the decisions aren't that person is really a viable model, right? I mean, these technology companies really are product companies. And a lot of the most important decisions, I think all of the most important decisions come down to what you're offering to the people that you serve, who are your users in the end, right? And I think that that's the most important thing, right? So we need to make sure that we handle all these things as part of the team. And that's why we spend a lot of time just trying to get the most talented folks on all of these different realms to join us. But I think for the long term, and it gets back to what I was saying before about how I don't think we're anywhere near the end of developing the platform. The platform decisions we make, the product decisions, the technology decisions we make are going to be the most important decisions we make over the next 5 or 10 years. And I think that that's what the roles are.
In the book, David describes a leather-bound notebook that you started carrying around in 2005. You used to scroll notes in it, and as you know, far back as 2005, you laid out your vision for the news feed, for opening registration to everyone, opening Facebook up to apps by outside developers. All of those things happened. What's in your book today, or if you're not keeping a book anymore,
you might be.
What are you thinking about? What's swirling around in your head?
I think I've talked about a lot of it, but I mean, the platform stuff, I think, is just there's so much more to do.
What should users of Facebook expect to see in the coming years? There's actually a good question here that ties into this. I mean, will we be able to make phone calls or do two-way video chats or get CNN video, for example, 24/7 on Facebook? Is that a possibility?
Well, I don't know if the goal is to get that inside Facebook.com, right?
Right.
I think what people should expect over the next 5 years is that virtually every important service that you use online, but eventually offline too, are going to get remade and designed from the bottom up with people at their center. Now, that might happen from forward-leaning incumbents in those spaces, or it might happen through disruption, through new entrepreneurs who are structurally have more of an incentive to take risks and just will overturn things like we're seeing with games now. But I think that that's what's going to be exciting, right? So we have a lot of work that we need to do to make sure that we build out that kind of plumbing properly, right? And that we build all the products on Facebook well enough to handle all of the different types of information that people are going to want to share and that are going to be flowing through the system. But if we can do that, then you can imagine the world is going to look a lot different, right? I mean, everything from how we get news, which won't necessarily be on Facebook, but maybe the CNN of the future or the New York Times of the future just looks a lot more social, right? Instead of just getting the picks that are from editors, you get picks from the people who you trust the most and who have similar interests, and the whole newspaper is personalized to the things that you've said that you're interested in. You know, we've already seen experiences where you can go to internet radio on Pandora and it just automatically starts playing the songs that you like, right? Without you having to do anything, because it's personalized. And you can turn it off if you don't want that experience, but it's a great experience.
We, of course, in our business know that there are major consequences for that as well.
And they're going to be good.
We hope so. I'm going to turn to some questions from some more questions.
I just want to say, there is no question that what he's saying should be listened to by anybody who's concerned about the future of Facebook. Facebook's goal and strategy is not to be a website long term. They are very consistent about it. Mark and his engineering and product people all say the same thing. The platform is Facebook's future. And that's basically what he's saying. That, it won't happen inside the confines of Facebook.com. Facebook is aiming to be a set of services that are applicable to people no matter what they do. And it really will extend beyond the internet itself. It's going to be on your web, on your phone, or your mobile device that you're going to carry with you. And you're going to apply it to increasingly everything you do, if he gets what he's trying to build, implemented. That's
I think if we don't succeed at building it, someone else will. So I just think that this is likely the way that things are going to go. If for no other reason that we've seen that every single app that has been built and designed with this methodology of building of design around people is significantly more engaging and grows faster than all the other types of apps that haven't. Right now, that doesn't mean that you can do it poorly and have it work, but whenever there are good entrepreneurs, whether it's folks who work at Facebook on photos or groups or events, or the folks who are kind of tackling games now, or people who are working on e-commerce stuff in the future, when people hit that, it's going to work. And we can be the platform that provides that. I think we are certainly in the lead now. We're not near the end, right? So there's a lot of room for innovation left, and we need to keep on moving in that direction if we want to help support this.
Mark, I got to get to some of these questions because there's some very good ones here. Here's one I like. It's the question is, as CEO, when was the last time you actually wrote code?
For Facebook or not?
Well, why don't you
answer the product again, are you?
Now.
Yeah. No, I mean, all the time for fun. I mean, I think it's really important that you use your own products, right? So, for example, I use Facebook.com all the time, and I use the mobile versions, right? I have an iPhone and I have an Android phone because I think it's important to use all these different things. If you want to build a platform, you also have to be a user of that. That means writing code, right? So, on the weekends, sometimes I do. The most recent time that I checked in code for Facebook.com was actually for the platform as well. Leading up to F8, which was in late April this year, that's our annual developer event, the platform team was just kind of sitting there, and they had this big monitor on the wall with the number of bugs that they had left to fix. And it was like, there's like 150 three nights before, and everyone was like pulling all-nighters constantly. And so it's like, all right, I've already written my keynote. I'll help out, right? So. And I figure that's like pretty good for morale, right? I mean, you get like the people, right? And Shrep joined in, right? Our head of engineering, and we just kind of sat there and we fixed some bugs and we wrote tests to make sure it was going to be stable when it launched, and it was fun, right? And it's also good because so much of the infrastructure of what we do requires having good code and good abstractions that actually being in there and being able to see the work that people are doing on a day-to-day basis just gives us a much clearer sense of kind of the investments that we need to be making to run the company better, to build better products over the long term.
What are the issues or things that keep you up at night?
I mean, the main thing is just that it just kind of gets back to this theme of there's so much more to do, and I mean, we're just this little company, right? I mean, we have 1,500 people now.
Little company worth $27 billion.
Well, I mean, who cares? I measure it in terms of the number of people who are working on it, right? And there are 400 engineers at the company, and right now about 150 really excited interns. who are writing code. But I mean, that's it, right? I mean, there's no other organization on the face of the earth that has 500 million people that it's serving with 400 people writing code for that. So I think the biggest question when you look at the ecosystem, and if you come to the conclusion that I have, that we are not near the end, right? We are not in maintenance mode. There's a lot more innovation. There are a lot more people. I mean, 500 people, 500 million people may be using the service today, but I think that this is something that over time everyone is going to want to use. Right? I mean, everyone has friends and family and wants to stay connected with those people, and they, you know, and so we have a lot more work that we need to do to get it there. The question is just, how do we get there, right? And are we moving fast enough, and how can we move faster? So, I mean, we do all these things, and we try to be bold, and we try to move quickly, but I actually think the biggest challenge might be maybe how can we move even faster?
Because you see other people creeping up?
I mean, it's just that the opportunity is so big, right? I mean, I think if we fail, then inevitably that will happen. But, you know, I think that there are companies that their primary dynamic, that they're primarily limited by competition, right? And they're in more of a zero-sum market where, you know, their win directly means someone else's loss. I don't see that as much with us. I mean, I think that there are competitors, and that's important, and we want to look out and see what good things other people are doing so we can learn from them. But it's not zero sum. I mean, there were a couple of years ago, there were many fewer people using Facebook. Now there are a lot more. In a few years, there will be a lot more people using social networks. It's our job to make sure that we build the best ones, so it's Facebook that they're using. And but the segment is growing, right? This behavior in the world is growing. I just want to make sure that we do our best at kind of getting the world there.
In David's book, he describes sort of the evolution of how you dealt with being the CEO, being 22 and now 26, and working with people older than you. Your COO, obviously, is, I believe, 14 years older than you. What, in your opinion, this is a question from the audience, makes a successful entrepreneur? Why are some people, why did you become a successful entrepreneur rather than others who had great ideas, who had some success but then failed? What do you think you did different, and are you still learning how to be a CEO?
Well, so I think there are actually two different things, being an entrepreneur and being a CEO. I've spent a lot of time thinking about this because, I mean, it's obviously a very important thing for me to reflect on, and talking to the folks around me. And what I really think it comes down to are two key things for building something well. One is just having a really strong sense of what you want to do, right? Because along the way, there are so many distractions that if you're not completely clear on what you want to do, you're going to get sidetracked. I was watching this interview with Steve Jobs once where he was basically, an entrepreneur asked him for advice. It's like, what would you say to me as an entrepreneur? And his advice was, make sure that you really love and care about what you're doing, because if you don't, it's so irrational, the amount of time and energy that you have to put into building what you're going to build, that it's just not worth doing, and you're going to fall off at some point along the way. So I think that's number one, is kind of being clear about what you want to do and really caring about it. Number two is building a good team, right? And like, that's what I spend a huge amount of time on. You know, when I'm not building products, and I don't even really build products anymore, I work with teams who build products. So I mean, it goes all the way down the organization from a really good head of engineering who can scale out and really get the respect of the best hackers and engineers and people who want to build stuff, to a head of product who can really communicate exactly what you're going to do to make sure that every person in your company knows exactly what the plan is, to really good business folks like Cheryl, who, you know, and keep in mind, any of these people could run the company. To the question before about, like, should I be running the company or not, I mean, if I were to disappear, any of them could run the company. And I just think that that's a really important thing when you're trying to build something, is you need to get great people around you, right? So, but I think if you have a clear idea of what you're doing and you have great people, then that's a lot of the battle.
You know, the scope of the vision that he had from the beginning was quite extraordinary. I think that in his case was a secret sauce element. But it's really interesting that he has been able to hire people from the time when, you know, from getting Sean Parker, you know, all the way through to Cheryl and all the amazing senior leaders that he has now, who really share the vision. I mean, the scope of the vision, to begin with, was very, very, very big. And he's done an amazingly good job at finding people who are good at all sorts of sub-segments of the tasks who also share the scope of the vision. That's kind of, if I were talking to, if you could mimic that, you're going to have a successful company.
And do you still, I mean, do you still sort of study how to be a CEO? I mean, do you still think about what you need to do and what you need to learn to do that job?
Yeah. I started this when I was 19 and I knew nothing, right? So, I mean, when I moved out here, I was so lucky in terms of just happening to meet the right people who could help us with the simplest things about building a company. Meeting venture capitalists to have seed investments so you don't have to keep on spending all of your college tuition. doing a contract to set up a data center, right? I mean, I took computer science classes. None of them were on how to set up a data center. we've made probably every mistake that you can make. And, you know, I think that, you know, if the plan plays out, right, and if the next 5 years are as exciting as the last five or six have been, then there are going to be a lot of hard decisions to make, and we better spend a lot of time thinking about how to get those right. And we're going to get a lot of them wrong, and we better learn from that.
I like this question. Says, you are always asked the same questions in every interview about privacy and data. And are there any questions that you wished people would ask you? What would you wish that I asked you or that David asked you?
You know, there's this odd dynamic in these interviews where the stuff that I'm most excited about at any point in time is what we're building now, and I can't talk about it.
What about openness and transparency, right?
I mean, we can talk about the future. I think we've touched on a lot of those topics. I don't know. Maybe I don't spend enough time thinking about that because I'm too busy answering the questions that I don't want.
But it is part of the price you pay for pursuing openness and transparency, which I think is a good thing. But at the same time, there are responsibilities that come with the pursuit of those ideas, right? I mean, fair enough, isn't it?
Are you talking about just doing interviews and things like that?
Yeah.
I mean, it's definitely important, I think, as the company is scaled, to make sure that all the people who use our service every day, which, I mean, is actually perhaps one of the most amazing statistics about Facebook. I mean, we talk about, you know, we just reached 500 million people are using Facebook. We've always had this crazy stat that more than 50% of our users use the site every day.
That's still true.
Still true, yeah. And we figured it would, you know, as we got into people who use computers less, that would stop being true, but it hasn't. Actually, in the last year, the percent has gone up, which I guess means we're doing a good job.
What is the percent?
It varies. So, I mean, I don't want to give a specific number, but you could say it's a little more than 50% use it every day.
Where do you see the largest growth potential, by the way?
Well, I mean, there are different countries, right? So for a while, our strategy was just kind of see where it grew. We had no targeted marketing or anything like that. I think that's an interesting thing about Facebook, too, is we don't do broadcast, right? I mean, we're not trying to market ourselves. The way that the site grows is because people tell their friends that they should be on it, and then they get their friends on it. So the whole marketing for the service is us basically giving people the tools that they need to get the people that they want onto the site. So we never, until very recently, targeted a specific country as a place that we wanted to grow in. We started off in colleges, and then from very early on, we basically took requests. I mean, people emailed in, said, okay, launch it at this college. And then when we had servers, early on, I mean, I was renting servers for $85 a month. We put ads up. When we had enough money, we rented more servers. When we had enough servers to have more capacity, we'd basically stack rank the colleges that wanted to get on Facebook and by the number of requests that people had sent us, and we opened it up to those colleges first. When we made it so that anyone could sign up, we built a tool so that users themselves could translate the service. So basically, we had this thing where we opened it up, and within 2 weeks, all of our users had submitted and voted on all these translations to translate every single string of text, of which there are tens of thousands, into Spanish. And then we opened it up to French, and they translated it in one day. I guess they're really passionate about their language. And that's kind of how it grew. And you know, people who wanted it in their country did the effort to get it in their country. Now, it's only recently that we're doing more targeted things. And the reason for that is that we ran out of countries. There are a couple of countries where we aren't yet the leader, but I think the trajectory is pretty clear that we will be, like Brazil. India, we just passed the previous leader there. So there are really only four countries that we're not the leading social network service in. It's Japan, Russia, Korea, South Korea, and China. So we're focused on that now. And this year, we're focused on Japan and Russia. We have three engineers. We're just like, all right, we've never done anything like this. We want to just get parachuted into Japan. And we want to just rent an apartment and code and go rogue. And so we're like, all right, go for it. And they're working on that. And you know, in Japan, I think we're already more than 1 million people, and they've been there for 6 or 9 months. So that's going pretty well. So that's one area for growth, or the countries that we haven't yet really gotten into. But the other one is just making it so that everyone uses the service, right? So I mean, we've seen countries get up to as much as 80% of the internet population on Facebook. And the theory is that it really is a universal service, right? Basically, everyone has friends and family, and they want to stay connected to those people, right? So people ask us these questions all the time of, how do people use it differently in different countries? How do people use it differently of different ages? And the thing that's crazy isn't how people use it differently, it's how similarly they all use it. There are differences, right? Differences here and there. I mean, there are different applications that people use in different countries, but by and large, it's really similar. And I think that that's why something like this will end up being extremely universal. There are countries where we're at 80% of the internet population are on Facebook, and there are countries like the US where I think we're around 130 million people are using it, and there's a lot more to grow. I think it's just going to be really interesting over the next few years. And this is one of the challenges of the company that's really fun, is we get to build products both for countries where there are no users yet, and for countries where a huge amount of people are on the service, and the real challenge is getting people who barely use their computers to be able to ramp up and wire up in a social network.
Mark, last summer, the State Department reportedly asked Twitter to delay a routine maintenance outage, and that was during the Iranian street protests, the demonstrations against the re-election of President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. If the government asked Facebook to do the same, to allow people to have access to a site where they can post information and videos and other material, would you do that? Would you honor that request?
You know, I think it depends on what it is exactly. Right? I mean, so we've never had that exact situation that they were in. I mean, we've had other ones, but it is really interesting. Some of the most interesting use cases that we've seen have been of people using Facebook for political purposes, right? So I mean, there's this example, I think you cover in the foreword of your book, right? Well, Oscar Morales.
Oh yeah, that's where the book starts.
And basically, in Colombia, right, there was the FARC, right? And a lot of people in the country are really opposed to that group, but I guess the group has a massive amount of control over media. And there was never before Facebook an outlet for people to organize or to express their concern about it. And this one guy was pretty brave, and he went out there and he made a group, and it was pretty easy to do, and he started spreading it, and before long, they had, what was it, like
10 million people in the streets 1 month later.
Yeah, all cities across
the
world.
That's kind of amazing.
Right, I mean, protesting FARC, and FARC had recently taken hostages, and there were a lot of other things going on around the time, so I don't think that he really claims credit for this, but I think that this was one of the things that put pressure on that organization to release the hostages, which they ended up doing. And I think things like that, that like large-scale political movements, are pretty interesting to see play out in this new medium. And I mean, so it's all this stuff, right? It's YouTube, it's Twitter, it's Facebook, and all this other stuff that's going to get built on top of these social platforms going forward. But I don't know, it's one of the really gratifying things about building this, is right, and we get to be just a part of kind of empowering people to do those things that they couldn't do before.
I think one of the most interesting things about Facebook is the tension that it's in so many countries, literally every country, pretty much, and so many of those countries are not truly free and democratic, and yet the governments let the internet operate and let Facebook operate. And attention is developing in a number of countries, which I consider extremely healthy, which Facebook is playing a very prominent role in, you know, in countries like Egypt, where it's been playing out very dramatically just in recent weeks. But you see it in, you know, in different ways in Indonesia, in, you know, Bangladesh even, and certainly Venezuela, Colombia. You know, it's really, really interesting that I always say Facebook is a platform for the empowerment of its members. And one of the things that I think people don't appreciate about the difference between Facebook and Twitter is that people get on Twitter to be broadcasters, right? But people get on Facebook to say, let's meet at the mall, right? But once they get on Facebook to meet at the mall, they happen to have acquired a broadcast platform that when they get upset about something political, they have at their disposal. So ordinary people find themselves in control of this political tool at the very moment when they need it, and it is not something a lot of governments are going to be that comfortable about going forward, and I think that's great.
Well, I mean, where do you draw the line, Mark? As you know, in Pakistan, for some time, the government blocked Facebook. There was a page set up by somebody. It was called Submit Your Cartoons of Muhammad. I mean, are you ever worried that you might be sort of, you know, targeted by some group that feels, well, you know, you're in charge of this company and you haven't shut it down?
Well, actually, I think someone is trying to get me sentenced to death in Pakistan now. That's not a joke. I mean, it might be funny, but it's not a joke. I mean, this is where I think you were asking before what you have to do to build something like this, and you have to really believe in what you're doing, right? I mean, we think that what we're doing is a really valuable thing in the world, and I hope I don't get killed.
I mean, obviously there are restrictions on pornography. How do you sort of decide? I mean, I know there's a policy, but you know, how do you sort of decide what skirts the line and what doesn't?
You know, one of the approaches that we take is I think that there are a lot of companies that that now are serving a very international user base, but really espouse American values, right? And to a point where I think it's almost, you know, it's like almost closed-minded, right? How much they only have American values and write off the values of other countries. And, you know, I think with our user base, right, and the community of people that are using Facebook, we really have as a goal to be an international company, right? We have 70% of people who are using Facebook outside of the US. And like you were saying, different countries have different standards for what hate speech is, right? So for example, in the US, we have one standard. In Germany, it's illegal to post anything with Nazi content, right? It's a law, it's in law. You can't post anything with Nazi content. And that's the decision that they made because they felt that it was very sensitive after World War II, right? And So our stance is that we respect that if it's a law, right? Different countries have different stances on what hate speech is, right? Now, if Germany came to us and said, don't allow Nazi content anywhere around the world, that would be ridiculous, right? And some people have, I mean, there have been blog posts written about this, like why does Facebook allow, you know, Holocaust denial and things like that, especially when, you know, the person running the company is Jewish. And it's like, because we believe in free speech. So that's why we do that. But we also don't want to take an American-centric approach to it, right? So where we think that we draw the line is, you know, when a country has a clear standard that's written into law, it isn't just being arbitrarily enacted, right, by the country. But I think that these are some of the really interesting questions that have to get resolved over time. But I think that for this next wave of companies, I mean, there are so many more people outside of the US than inside the US. I think you want to have that global perspective, right? That, you know, we believe in certain things. Like, we believe that openness and transparency and free speech are good, and that giving people the tools to share things are generally going to be valuable all over the world. But we also believe that you should respect other cultures. So, I don't know, that's our take.
Last question for you, Mark, before we have to wrap up. On paper, of course, we all know that you are a billionaire. You're a very wealthy guy. Or you have the potential to be if you sold the company and you had opportunities. Where do you see yourself in 20 years and beyond? I mean, with your name on buildings, a public philanthropy, following in the footsteps of Bill Gates, running a different company, even living here in Silicon Valley?
You know, it's funny to think about. I don't know how many of you guys are, you know, Kevin Rose. He's the founder and CEO of Dig. And he once had this awesome quote that, you know, there's this story on the front page of, I think it was Business Week, that was like how this kid made $80 million or $60 million in 2 years. And he's like, all right, this is ridiculous. This is a private company. It's like, I don't have any money. And he does this podcast, or this weekly video, where he sits on a couch with another guy, and they talk about whatever the biggest issues are that are facing Dig. And someone asked him what he thought of that piece. And he goes, you know, it's funny. It's like, I'm not a millionaire. I'm not even a thousandaire. I had to borrow money to buy the couch that we're sitting on. So, you know, I don't know. In terms of that, I don't think it affects me.
I did once hear Mark ask Jim Breyer for a raise because he was moving into a bigger place.
So the most important thing to me, and this is maybe a kind of a funny story, is I just want to live within walking distance of our office. Right? It's California. It's beautiful. I want to be able to walk to work. And we moved offices from downtown Palo Alto University Ave to California Ave, and to get a bigger building so we can have everyone in one place. And we had to. So we moved to this new place, and I just wanted a new apartment that was within walking distance of the office. So, you know, so my assistant was looking for an apartment for weeks and weeks and weeks, and finally I was out traveling somewhere and I get this phone call and she calls me and goes, "All right, I found an apartment. I'm renting it." Oh, sorry, I found a small house. I'm renting it. So I literally, like, I hadn't even seen the house before I moved in, because, like, I don't care, right? I mean, like, I don't spend any time there. I'm at the office the whole time, right? What I want to be able to do is be able to walk home at the end of the day, sleep, and then go back to the office. So, I don't know, that's me. That's...
And in 20 years from now?
I mean...
Bill Gates, philanthropy?
I think we'll see. I really care about what we're doing. I think there's a lot more to do. I think this trend towards people sharing more, towards the world becoming more open and transparent, is, I think, one of the most transformative things in society over the next 10 or 15 years. Maybe longer, who knows? But that's what we're focused on. There's a lot more to do, it's really exciting.
Mark Zuckerberg, David Kirkpatrick, thank you.
That was good.
Thank you. Thank you.